Hi, Sarah. We can't hear you at the moment. I'm not sure what's happening there, but okay. I will take over for now. Maybe you have to log in and log back out, but I will introduce our first speaker of the evening. Nigel, can you hear us?
I can indeed, yes. I can hear you, Thomas.
Brilliant.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear, loud and clear. Okay, so I am about to get your presentation up for you. Really good to have you here tonight. I know there's a lot of people, especially to see you this evening in the room. So over to you.
Okay, many thanks, Thomas, and good evening to everybody out there. And I hope you're all staying safe and looking after yourselves and keeping well during these difficult days, but what is actually a beautiful evening. So thank you very much for sparing me some time to share the interest and the excitement of Central Asia Metals PLC. My name is Nigel Robinson, and I'm the Chief Executive Officer. Just go through the usual disclaimer to start off. Just read that at your will, please, if you could. Obviously, slightly too quick to actually read, so apologies for that, but standard disclaimer. So Central Asia Metals, what do we do and where do we operate? Firstly, we have two operations in Kazakhstan and in North Macedonia. In Kazakhstan, we have a copper producing facility known as SXEW process, solvent extraction, electro winning, and we produce there in the order of between 12,500 to 13,500 tons annually of cathode copper. We operated this mine, and more about it later on. We've been operating there and producing copper since April 2012. And on the back of the success at Kounrad, we then went and purchased an underground lead and zinc mine in North Macedonia, which is in the Balkans area, where we produce lead and zinc in a concentrate form and an output of around 23 to 25,000 tons of zinc in concentrate and 29 to 32,000 tons of lead in concentrate annually. Both of our mines have long lives. They're out beyond 2034 is the timeline for Kounrad and 2038 for the Sasa underground lead and zinc mine. Just moving further on, just a bit of a results highlight from 2019. Now, for many of us, this may seem like almost a decade ago, given everything that's happened in the first quarter and into the second quarter of 2020. But worth just reiterating these numbers that we announced on April the 1st. In terms of all our measures that we measure ourselves by, production, we came in at the upper end of our range. So you can see the numbers there. We produced 13,771 tons of copper in a guidance of 12,500 to 13,500. And we produced 23,369 tons of zinc in concentrate and 29,201 tons of lead in concentrate. Both of those, again, up in the upper end of the guidance range for the year. On a safety point of view, we had a very good performance in terms of what we call LTIFR, which is our lost time injury frequency rate of 0.42 against the previous year, which was slightly disappointing, of 3.76 in 2018. So a good improvements in 2019, even though one LTI, which we had during the course of the year, was too many, and we target zero as our goal. And on the back of that strong health and safety performance and production performance, we produced some very good financial numbers. Revenues just north of $180 million, with EBITDAs of $108.6 million, representing about a 60% EBITDA margin for the year. Our gross debt was down to $108.8 million, and we finished the year with around about $32 million in the bank in terms of cash. And the final number I'll give on the finances, which is a key number for us, it drives our dividend repayment back to shareholders, a free cash flow $69.8 million in the year. So good numbers for 2019, and we've been producing good numbers ever since we listed on the stock exchange back in 2010. I won't go through all the detailed history over the past 10 years of the company. You can see it on the slide there, but basically we developed the Kounrad project in Kazakhstan. We've subsequently expanded that through our own cash flows, taking it up to the current level of output, which is where we expect to be throughout to the life of mine in 2034. We then acquired Sasa, as I said before, back in the 2017. On the 6th of November, we finalized that transaction, paying $402.5 million for that asset in North Macedonia. And since then, we've been integrating that asset into our business, and now we hold two low cost, long life operations in those metals. And through that period, we've paid back to shareholders $176 million in dividends, representing about 98 pence per share. Just moving on to value, you can see the value from the numbers I've just told you about for 2019. Strong EBITDA margins, industry-leading EBITDA margins indeed, based on the back of two low-cost operations. And we've got a good track record of paying dividends back annually since we created a dividend policy for ourselves back in 2012. And as I say, we've now paid back $176 million in that time. But we don't just operate the business for the shareholders. Obviously, they're a key component of our business, but there's lots of other stakeholders in the business, and something we recognize and have been very, very focused on over the time since we've been operating the businesses. And we've had since 2013 in place a CSR director on site, so corporate social responsibility. And we fully recognize as a business that that's broadened out now to sustainability and ESG. But I think it's true that we've focused on those aspects of CSR way back for the past 6 or 7 years, all the time we've been operating the assets. This year is the first year we've put out our first sustainability report, and we've strengthened our sustainability team by employing recruiting a new non-executive director, Dr. Gillian Davidson, to the board to challenge the management team and all the aspects of sustainability. In terms of delivering that sustainability report, we did a desktop review and assessed that there were five key areas that were important to us and that our stakeholders would be interested in. That is delivering value through stewardships or strong corporate governance and license to operate in the countries that we operate in, maintaining a strong health and safety culture, focusing on our people and making sure that we recruit the right people, that we develop those people and train them appropriately, and we manage them throughout their whole time with the CAML group. And looking after the environment in terms of everything that we do, both at Sasa and at Coonrod, both in terms of water usage, air quality, how we manage the tailings, how we manage our greenhouse gas emissions and everything. And then finally, working closely with the communities in our area, both at Sasa and at Coonrod. Just a little bit more on each of those pillars of the sustainability that I mentioned. Health and safety. We had a good year in 2019, as I mentioned before. And one of the key metrics we have is what's our LTIFR, lost time injury frequency rate. Down in 2019, as you can see on the table there, to 0.42 from the previous year where it was 3.76. And that's down to an improved health and safety culture, which we're constantly monitoring across both sites. And various initiatives that we look to install throughout Sasa and at Coonrod. There's a few examples there on the slide, and I won't go through those necessarily in detail given the time that we've got. COVID-19, obviously, this is important to us, looking after our staff during this very difficult time with the pandemic. Both countries, North Macedonia and Kazakhstan, have got instances. This morning, Kazakhstan number was over 9,000 cases, and in North Macedonia, it's over 2,000 cases. But I'm very pleased to report that so far, we've not had any instances amongst our employees or contractors, nor have we got any instances of the virus in the local towns in which we operate. So we've managed to change our operating procedures, improved the hygiene standards, social separation, all the things you probably expect of most companies nowadays to make sure that we mitigate against the risk of COVID-19. And that's what we've been doing. And throughout this period, in Q2 in particular, where we face the greatest risk, we've managed to maintain production throughout, also maintain delivery of all our goods across the borders, and to maintain the safety and well-being of our staff, despite both countries going into a state of emergency for the crisis and closing the borders and introducing various stages of curfew. And along with the rest of the world and much of Western Europe, both countries are now starting to relax some of those restrictions that they've had in the country. But we're very cognizant that we must keep our guard up to maintain the safety and well-being of our staff, maintain our production, and maintain the deliveries of product across the border to maintain the revenue streams. Focusing on our people, mentioned that before, we've now got over 1,000 people in the group and 190 odd contractors on site at any one stage, slightly fewer now with COVID-19. But one thing we're particularly proud of is that most of those employees, 99% in fact, come from the countries of operation. So local employees, well trained by by London staff at the appropriate time, be it technical or on sustainability matters or even commercial matters. And we only indeed have one expat, true expat, who's been our CSR director that I mentioned before, Nick Shirley, who's been with us since 2013. 12% of our employees are female, and we have a low staff turnover in terms of both Sasa and Kunrad for the movement of staff through, be it through retirement or voluntary means. In terms of caring for the environment, I mentioned before, we take this very seriously. We look after the environment. In fact, the Kunrad project itself, you could argue, is a project which is there to actually clean up the environment that we found when we won the tender to acquire that particular project. But in terms of spills or environmental spills, we had zero significant spills at either operation, either last year or throughout the lives of the project since we've been managing them. Zero air quality exceedances. We had a project last year to improve the net water consumption at Sasa by using more of the recycled water coming through the mine, putting it back into the flotation plant, which is something we're proud of in terms of improving the use of water on site. 17,000 trees have been planted at Sasa in decommissioning some of the tailings facility sites. And we've got long-term plans in place at the moment to see if we can manage the tailings process through a more environmentally friendly process by putting the up to 40% of the tailings back underground through a life of mine review that we're doing at Sasa. And last but by no means least, greenhouse gas emissions. The first time we've published these, we are looking at ways in which we can improve the intensity of our greenhouse gas emissions by various studies into looking at possibly air power, wind power, should I say, or solar power, other means of actually reducing our intensity of greenhouse gas emissions. It is a start of a process. We haven't as yet set specific targets, but we will be looking at those over the course of this year to see what we can actually achieve and what is practical for the business to achieve to help the environment, environments in which we operate. Unlocking value for our community is probably the last pillar that here, but very important to us. And since we've owned Kunrad, we've had in place now for many years a policy whereby 0.25% of the revenue is given back voluntarily to the community for projects that we manage with the community in mind. And we've introduced exactly the same process at Sasa, and we will continue to do that. And throughout the pandemic and the COVID-19 issues, we've contributed to both communities about over $200,000 in terms of a ventilator, PPE, food packages, and donations in Macedonia to a central fund to help the health ministry there. So lots of communications and relationships with the community going through this current crisis of COVID-19. So that's sustainability, something that's fundamental to the business. But moving on to the operational side of it now, and just having a bit of a closer look at the actual operations of Sasa, first of all, which is a zinc and lead mine. You can see the diagram there, which shows the cross-section of the ore body. There are three ore bodies at the mine, Svinjareka, Kozjareka, and Golemareka. The main ore body we're operating in at the moment, if you can see the pointer there, is Svinjareka. That's a skarn-hosted deposit. It's got mechanized underground railway tracks and equipment, obviously. And most of the ore is hoisted to the surface through the Golemareka shaft. That's 70% approximately the ore gets hoisted to the surface. The rest is trucked to the surface, about 30% of it. But the main haulage level at the moment is 830, and we're operating just above that main haulage level at the moment. Prior production, you can see that when we acquired the mine and bought the mine at the back end of 2017, the mine was operating just sub 800,000 tonnes per annum, both in terms of ore mined and plant feed. Slowly but surely, we've increased that throughput. We're now looking at last year, we mined 817,000 tonnes, and we got a feed through to the plant of about 820,000 tonnes. And through various minor improvements across the patch at Sasa, we've that's informed us to be able to guide this year 825,000 to 850,000 tons. So since we've owned it, probably an increase of 50 to 60,000 tons or sub 10%, but just so small marginal improvements with minimal capex to improve the operation performance of the mine. And you can see historically what attracted us to buying this mine, very strong, consistent record of output, both in zinc and in lead. Some of the improvements I talked about there, minor improvements that we've made, really bringing the mine up into the 21st century with 3D computer software, increased automation of the underground fleet, Line of sight remote control. We've introduced internet underground, which provides good data analysis of how the machines are being used, how they're being utilized, where they are. We've ordered 6 new units for the underground fleet, which will be delivered in the first half of this year. And there's a further 3 to be delivered 2021 and then further 2022 as well. A total of 12 new units to be delivered to site. And one of the other key things which we installed at the back end of the year and commissioned earlier this year was a new tertiary crusher, which allows a throughput from the flotation plant up to 850,000 tonnes per annum. So a marginal improvement, as I said before. Longer term, we're looking at the future for the mine. We're looking at under a life of mine review, which the Chief Operating Officer, Scott Yelland, is conducting and driving forward to see what is the best way of mining those ore bodies, Svinjareka, Golemareka and Kozjareka. And in principle, the board agreed in December at the end of last year to move to a cut and fill mining technique, which is generally considered safer, also allows us to put some of the tailings back underground and therefore minimize the use of the tailings facilities on surface. It's more flexible and more suited to the geometry of the ore body, which pinches and swells and therefore will enable us to get higher recoveries and lower dilution in terms of the ore that we recover from the mining techniques. And we've got detailed engineering studies to complete on that, which will be scheduled to be completed in the second half of this year in 2020. I mentioned tailings before. Obviously, something's very topical in the mining business. We've taken the opportunity over the past year or so to review how that tailings facility, the old tailings facility and the current one that we just finished, are monitored. They are downstream facilities, which are the safest types of facilities in tailings dams. We just completed off what we call our TSF4 facility, which will give us sufficient capacity to last for just north of 6.5 plus million tons of tailings for the next 6 to 7 years. But clearly, as I said before, the life of mine is out to 2038. So we need to look at a longer lifeline in terms of how we manage tailings above and beyond that. And that's where the cut and fill aspect of mining is coming into play, and potentially looking at dry stack tailing as well. And just in terms of a review for the safety angle, we've had Golders on site to check the procedures for monitoring the old tailings facilities and make sure that everything we are doing is as safe as possibly can be. And last but by no means least on this particular point, we've had full disclosure in line with the Church of England Pension Board requirements, and we are working towards adopting the standards that will be implemented for all tailings dams across the world. In terms of cost, what attracted us to SASA in the first place is its low operational costs and capital costs. And you can see their numbers that we reported in 2019. A C1 cash cost of 47 cents per pound, and the breakdown there on the various tables. But if you consider what zinc is currently selling at, which is around about the 90 cents per pound, you can see the strong margins we make, even on depressed prices for zinc at the moment, zinc and lead, I should say, for at the moment, a 60% EBITDA margin on site, given strong cost control. And we estimate we're just on the cusp of the lowest quartile, which is where we like to operate in order that we can't control the price of the product we create, obviously. But if you can control of your costs, it leads to a better outcome in terms of profitability margins.
You've got 2 minutes left.
Finally, coming on to the Kounrad, an aerial view here. Many of you know the Kounrad operation. This is the project that really was led to our success in the marketplace. Aerial view there. It is in situ dump leaching and therefore low cost. You can see the SXEW plant there by the eastern dumps. We've almost exhausted about another 2 or 3 years life left on the eastern dumps. We've put all the infrastructure in place to actually manage the western dumps. That's 2 12-kilometer pipelines to go from the plant out to the western dumps, and about 2/3 of the ore bodies in the western dumps. And we estimate we've got about 160,000 tons of recoverable copper still to go. The western dumps are performing very much in line with the leach curve. You can see that just at the bottom of this current slide, and you can see the seasonality of the operation over the years. That's just a chart at the top there, which shows our production. More copper produced in Q2 and Q3, but we do produce copper throughout the year, and there is slight different metallurgy both between the eastern dumps and the western dumps, but that's all planned and managed for in terms of giving us a life out to 2034, the end of the license. And lastly, but no means least, on copper, in terms of Kounrad's copper cost and its cash cost, well into the lowest decile here. And you see the cost curve there from Wood Mackenzie and where we currently operate, which is well into the lowest decile, as I say, with an EBITDA margin around about 76%, and producing copper at 52 cents per pound on a C1 cash cost basis. Capital allocation, important to us in terms of how we use the cash we generate from these low-cost assets. And there's a waterfall chart you can see there of how we've paid down the debt at Sasa. When we acquired Sasa in late 2017, we had about $194 million of debt. We've subsequently paid that down to $109 million of debt at the year end in 2019. And we're currently paying back $3.2 million of debt off the capital every month. That's one of our priorities. And the other priority is obviously to pay dividends back to our shareholders, and we've been doing that since 2012. We have a strong track record in that, having paid $176 million back. And the future for us, well, managing through this crisis, maintaining our operations, maintaining production, maintaining the strong balance sheet that we have, and then sustaining future debt repayments and therefore into dividend repayments as well, and looking at further growth opportunities for the business as and when they arise on, I have to say, probably an opportunistic basis in terms of trying to grow the business. On that point, I'm conscious that we've come towards the end of my 20 minutes. I'll hand back to the host for the evening, and I'm more than welcome to take any questions off anybody on in the Zoom audience.
Nigel, thank you very much indeed. Hopefully everyone can hear me now. I thought it was going to be a case of all dressed up and nowhere to go. April the 18th was a memorable day for you, Nigel. The Kounrad Copper Recovery Plant reached the milestone of producing 100,000 tons of copper cathode. What is the next milestone of that nature?
I guess that's a very good question, actually. I mean, that milestone took us 8 years. We don't really have a specific milestone in that regard. I mean, clearly our milestones are set each year. We set targets each year to maintain production at good levels. We have a strong focus on maintaining the well-being of the staff and the health and safety of the staff, and cost milestones, really. We had a milestone this year to deliver on our first sustainability report, and I think we've delivered on that as well. Above and beyond that, it's improving on, you know, our focus on sustainability and improving the business. And as I, you know, probably slightly rushed towards the end, so I apologize, but didn't really get a chance to say, having bedded in Sasa into the way we do business, our real focus is to grow the business above and beyond this. We do recognize there's very little growth in both of those assets, but they're very good assets themselves. And we need to look for opportunities outside of Sasa and Kounrad to grow the business. So that's a target we set ourselves. But I guess in terms of Kounrad and the lovely target we achieved in April of 100,000 tons from waste, let's not forget it was waste ore that nobody could actually get any value out of. And we've managed to get a lot of value out of it. The target there for Kounrad will be 200,000 tons of copper, which will probably be on the current levels in 8 years' time, I suspect.
question from floor, as it were, from our Zoom audience. Could you qualify the financial cost of COVID-19?
That's a very difficult question. In terms of local and controllable costs that we have, I would put it in the just hundreds of thousands of dollars, like $200,000 in terms of PPE and those kind of costs. If you take the overall inclusive cost of issues associated with managing the mines and people being off from work, etc., you'd have to do more of a detailed exercise. But in terms of our own business, we've managed, as I said before, to produce throughout the crisis. We're not getting ahead of ourselves and getting overconfident. We're still very vigilant on a day-to-day basis and working with the governments to have the required paperwork and permits to get through curfews and get our goods delivered across the border. So we're not overconfident in that. So as I say, we manage it closely, but the cost to us in that, in terms of disruption, has been fairly minimal in that sense, because it's just a question of more PPE and looking after the staff. The donations we've made, which are in excess, um, in, in combination of both sites over $200,000, we don't consider that a cost because we would have contributed to the community in another way had COVID-19 not happened. It's just the most suitable way of dealing with this current crisis and helping the community. So that is not an additional cost in many ways. So I'd say in our case, the cost has been minimal. Where you look at the future markets of the metals that we produce and the impact on the prices of those metals, that is going to be a little bit costly because that market is significantly depressed because of world demand at the moment. And that's where I think it's not so much a cost necessarily, but a reduced revenue will hit most mining businesses for the next few years as we work our way through this particular impact on the world economy.
Okay, so just looking at the slide that we can all see on Webinar Jam now, does the strong balance sheet allow you to be opportunistic with acquisitions?
I mean, I hope everybody comes through this crisis in good shape, effectively. But yes, I mean, we've always been a little bit opportunistic because growing a mining business like this, you have to be a little bit like that. I mean, you have to look at where the geology takes you and where the geography takes you in terms of the ore bodies, etc., to find those opportunities. And nothing's ever perfect when you look at them. It may not be in the right jurisdiction, or technically there may be problems or too much debt. So it is opportunistic the way we look at trying to grow the business effectively. And I suspect possibly as we come out of this crisis, there may be more opportunities arising where companies may be distressed or where the price is eating into the cost curve so much that there will be opportunities for us maybe to acquire businesses. So yes, we do look at that. And the key for us over the past 2 or 3 months, since this all became a significant world problem, has been to preserve liquidity, look after the balance sheet, and make sure that we come through this crisis in a strong position.
So at the end of trading today, market capitalization was 274 million. I'm just wondering how this valuation compares to your peers in the sector. Who are those peers? And how does the analyst community value the company?
Well, I think all everybody in our sector has declined on the back of declining metal prices. I'd say that we are undervalued at the moment. We've suffered as a consequence of this. So the key really for us has been to get through this exercise, maintain the production, and the valuation will take care of itself, provided we take care of what we can control, which is health and safety on site, its production, and it's managing the output of those metals. I can't influence the metal prices, but I can influence how we perform on a cost basis. So we'll look after the costs, capital and operating costs, and the valuation will take care of itself. And the next stage for us, really, in terms of improving that share price, is to look at opportunities to grow the business, make sure we get back onto paying dividends back to shareholders. And that's what our whole exercise of hunkering down effectively during the COVID crisis was about, really, to make sure we can get through this and see a little bit of light at the tunnel. And I have to emphasize that we didn't pay a final dividend for 2019. I didn't major on that during the presentation, but the whole reason we didn't do that was simply because of the risk of potentially having to go into a care and maintenance and having to shut down the operations, be it for a force majeure from the smelters, not being able to ship the product across the borders, the government imposition of some restrictions that stopped us producing. It was those risks that caused the board to decide, and it was a rather painful decision to actually decide not to pay a final dividend. It was not the low metal prices. As a low cost operator, we can still make good profitable, good profit margins on low metal prices. Clearly, we'd like them to be higher, but we still make money even at low metal prices because we operate in the lowest quartile. So it's about surviving this, maintaining your profit margins, and we will review the dividend as we come out of this and have greater clarity for the future.
Okay, because there's been an awful lot of questions throughout the day prior to the forum this evening and now on the chat that I can see, there's lots of people concerned about the dividend and asking you quite possibly, quite unfairly, what the dividend policy is going forward.
Well, let me re-emphasise, our dividend policy is that we pay back 30 to 50% of the free cash flow from Sasa and Kounrad. That has not changed. And last year, 2019, as I mentioned right at the early part of the presentation, we generated close to $70 million of free cash flow. So in a normal environment, we would have paid back between 30 to 50% of that. And in fact, just for 2019 alone, from the interim dividend we paid last October, we paid back 6.5 pence, which I think on the current share price, just on that first part of the dividend was a yield of around about 4.5%. Now, clearly, as we came into March and the crisis was increasing and the world was going into lockdown, including the countries in which we operated, we had to take a decision that became, if I'm perfectly honest, easier and easier as the days went by, as it became more clear that the world was going into lockdown and that we needed to do the same. The decision on the dividend became easier the longer that went on in some ways, because in the early part of March, we were considering what dividend do we pay. So the decision not to pay that final dividend was purely born out of the risk associated with going into care and maintenance in the second quarter or third quarter as we face these risks of COVID-19, not the metal prices. I must emphasize that. We've got a good track record of paying dividends, $176 million back, 98 pence per share since we started a dividend policy in December 2012. And we will certainly be looking at that again. The dividend policy has not changed, but we need to make sure that we manage the business, first of all, look after our staff, manage the cash flows, manage the balance sheet, and then we'll start paying back money to shareholders as soon as the time is right to do that at the appropriate time.
Okay, well, finally, at the last AGM, yourself, Nick Clark, Gavin Ferrer, Nigel Hurst Brown, Robert Cathery, you could have all retired from the board, but you all chose to stand again and be reappointed. No one wants to leave. So I think that's sort of a vindication of where the entire board views the future of the company.
Well, I hope so. I mean, we've all been with the company quite some time, and I know there are rules about rolling over after 9 years and everything, but there's a strength in smaller companies having continuity of experienced management who've brought the business to this current position. Obviously, in the fullness of time, we'll all retire and all, you know, at various stages move off the board and move from our positions. But we're great believers that you need to have continuity as well to maintain the strength of the business. And that experience, particularly in people like Nick Clark and, you know, Nigel Hurst Brown and Bob Cathery, are vital, really, to drive the business, make sure that the executive team, which is myself and Gavin Farrar, are you know, manage the business sensibly and properly and have the benefit of that experience to guide us along the way, really.
Nigel, that's good to hear. Time's up. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Really appreciate it. Thanks very much indeed.
Thanks very much. Thanks for your time.
You're welcome. You're welcome. So I'm sorry that I was mute at the beginning of the presentation. It's probably because the boss realised that I was going to tell some dreadful joke. But what isn't a joke, certainly by any means, is our next company, which is Touchstone Exploration. Market cap of £82 million at Touchstone Exploration, listed on AIM and the Toronto Stock Exchange. It is an international upstream company active in the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, one of the largest independent onshore oil producers in Trinidad, and its local connections run deep. Yesterday, we learned the company had agreed a 7-year, $20 million US dollar loan with the country's Republic Bank. There are 700 people watching you, Paul Bay. Paul Bay is the chief executive. Tell us more. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Sarah. Really appreciate that, and really appreciate everybody that's dialed in here tonight. It's great. You can see from behind me, it's not night here. I'm in Calgary, and it's almost midday, so good morning to everybody. What I'd like to do today is walk you through a little bit of an update from where we were in previous presentations that we've given to this group. And what I'd also like to do is lay out what our plan is for the remainder of 2020 and into 2021. Talked a little bit about in that summary, Sarah mentioned that we're one of the significant oil producers in Trinidad. The biggest transition that you're going to see through this year and into next year is by the end of next year, we'll probably be 80% natural gas and 20% oil and liquids. So that will be a big change, and I'll walk through that. Obviously, disclaimer, like everybody's showing you, pretty standard. I'm going to be providing you with some forecasts and some best estimates, but those do change as commodity prices and more information becomes available. So we'll go from there. Why invest in Trinidad? This is a slide that we've had in here for quite a while, but I think there's a couple of key components for us now. when you look at where they are in the LNG, about the eighth largest exporter of LNG, they have a very large industrial base for methanol, for ammonia, for various different petrochemical facilities. That wasn't that important to us before, but the main feedstock for all of those different facilities is natural gas. And with our recent discoveries, it's really key that we basically show that there's a good demand for gas. And actually currently on the island, there's a shortage of natural gas. And if you want to see a really interesting piece, there's a master gas plan for Trinidad that you can pull off of the web that'll give you a good idea of some of those stats. With regards to COVID-19, Trinidad actually took a very, very proactive approach, probably more proactive than most countries around the world. They actually shut their borders down, not only to foreigners, but also to nationals very quickly. They basically stranded a bunch of their people all throughout the world. And as a result of that, they really only ended up with about 120 cases. I don't think there's been any new cases in 3 or 4 weeks. Dedicated one hospital, did a bunch of things that I think the rest of us maybe wish had happened a little quicker. The result of that is this study that's just come out from Oxford University that's ranked Trinidad number 2 of companies that are prepared to come out of this lockdown. And it's going to allow us to move very quickly to get going as we go forward. So commend everybody involved in that. Touchstone, the key part of my focus today will be the fourth item, which is really the significant exploration opportunities. Talking about how these natural gas discoveries we've made, liquids-rich natural gas discoveries, are really going to transform the company from where we are today going forward. And I think you've seen some of that in the rise in the share price. And as we finish off 2020 into 2021, and hopefully we can prove that the repeatability of the beginning of the program, it'll give some people some very big comfort in the potential opportunity that we have here. So parts I'm going to talk about today, exploration upside. Not only is it exploration, it's now kind of gone from exploration and it's going to be moving into the development side. We've got some good development projects that we can scale up. Value creation, I think what you'll see is that virtually all the cash that we have on hand is going to go into the capital program. Our base production covers all of our overhead and our current costs, even at these low oil prices. Talk quickly about the environmental stewardship. We think that we're setting the high bar for companies operating in Trinidad, and then some of the community leadership things that we're doing as well. So this is really the map of southern Trinidad. Venezuela sits about 11 kilometers actually to the south and to the west of the island. It kind of wraps around the island a little bit. And we've really got two main things that we talk about. One is this developed acreage, which is that orangey-red part where we've got shallow oil wells that we can drill. We've got about 200 drilling locations over there. Obviously, at current prices, that will not be the focus of the program. The focus of the program will be out on the exploration acreage, which we call Oratoa. And about a year ago, if I had shown you this map, it was nothing but a concept. I think the last time I presented, I brought in a video of just having tested this little field out here called Coho. And since then, we've made a discovery out at Cascadura that is really a world-class gas pool that I'll talk about. So let me talk with the exploration upside. This is a blow-up map of the prospects out in Oratoa. Coho is the first well I'll talk about. Then I'll move over here and talk about Cascadura, where we're designing a follow-up location, Chinook, and then a final well that's Royston. A couple of key things on this particular map. This red line is the gas line that goes through the middle of the property that goes up to the industrial facility. So our tie-in will probably be at one of these two triangles for any of that gas. Royston likely come down to this tie-in point, and Coho is going to come down to a third-party operated facility when we tie it in. There is also an oil line going through the middle of the property. Depending on how much liquids we get out of these, we can build a line down there. The key part of this map is the infrastructure is all in place, and most of the money that we spend will be spending on drilling wells and adding reserves for the shareholders. Four prospects we have: Coho, gas discovery; Cascadura, liquids-rich gas discovery; Chinook, the next well that we're going to move to probably in June. We will move to in June, and we'll drill during the month of July. And then Royston, I'll talk about that. That's probably the biggest prospect we have. We were hoping to drill it later this year. Realistically, it's likely going to be Q1 of next year now. Coho, this was the first well that we drilled. It was the smallest target we had in the exploration program. And what we did is we re-drilled an old well that was drilled around 2001, drilled it using some new technology, 3D seismic, moved up structure. And quite frankly, it was really the game changer for allowing us to really develop the model that we had to make sure that we knew what we were doing, or at least started to know what we were doing. And what the well did, it far exceeded our expectations, tested almost 20 million cubic feet a day with very, very low drawdown. Happy to report that well will be brought on stream probably in October now. We've lost a couple of months as a result of COVID, but brought on stream in October. And to give you an idea, it's basically going to double our current production today. A couple of highlights on here is the Crown royalty rate is 12.5%. And there's no additional royalties on top of that, just corporate taxes after that. So that's the Coho project that's moving ahead. We've awarded the contract to a local operator. Everything's on the island, so they're moving forward, and we're just finalizing approvals with the government. Then we went over to Cascadura, and I think when I showed you this last time in the presentation that I gave, we were looking for about a 400 barrel a day oil well, again, offsetting an old well that was drilled by Shell. When we drilled it, we were going to move up structure on the 3D, and we certainly did move up structure, and we encountered a very, very thick liquids-rich gas zone. Tested 26.9 million cubic feet a day of gas and almost 700 barrels a day of liquids. That was clearly restricted by the equipment we had. That maxed out the test equipment. There's no bigger test equipment on the island, so that's where we did. We then went and ran a second test, and we pushed equipment a little bit harder. We got to 30 million cubic feet a day. But these two tests are in the same sand. One's a lower part of the sand and one's an upper part. I think the key thing to note here is that we didn't get any water on these and very, very low drawdowns. So liquids rich gas at these kind of rates. I mean, basically you see a well here that on the test was capable of about 10,000 BOEs a day. And for a company that's currently doing 1500 BOEs a day, you can see the transformational nature of what we're doing here. We did pull the recorders on this once some of the restrictions got lifted. The downhole recorders got pulled just after the 15th of May, and they're in being processed. I know I had promised to try to get something out by the end of May, but with COVID and having to move the data around in Trinidad and get it to our engineers here in Canada has been a little more challenging. So it's probably going to be a little bit delayed, but certainly nothing material. And like everything we do, as soon as we have the information, we'll pass it along to you as quickly as we can. Following that, we'll then get a full-blown reserve report. And I'm guessing that's probably another 4 to 6 weeks away in what we're doing. So all I can say about this Cascadura is this really is a world-class gas discovery. It, we didn't have to frack this. We didn't do anything. As a matter of fact, we couldn't even get as deep as we wanted to get because the well was just flowing at us. So we had to terminate this early and go with what we went. But it really is, I've been doing this a long time, 30 years, and I've never seen anything really like this. It really looks spectacular. So next well we're going to drill is Chinook, which is actually a mile south of Cascadura on the same access road. As I mentioned, we'll be moving in there hopefully in June. We'll be drilling it during July. It's the same concept as Cascadura, where we're taking an old well that was drilled. We think there's some really good shows on the logs, taking the 3D seismic, moving up structure, and drilling this particular well. So expect results on that sort of the end of July, beginning of August. We have made some minor changes to the rig that we think will be very helpful in what we're doing. And it's given us a little time during this downtime to take advantage of some of that technology. So before we went into the program, this is the project that I was most excited about. I really think this is really exciting. You look at the size of the structure, you look at the logs and where it is. It's this one. It's exploration, it's a separate structure. It carries all of those risks, but I think it's very, very exciting. And then the fourth well we were gonna drill was the Royston well, which is on the eastern part of the block more easternly part of the block. There's a long road that has to come into this particular location. It's gonna cost about $1 million. We would have been building that road during April, May, June, but obviously with COVID, we had to stop all of that. So what that's gonna do is push us into the wet season, which makes the road building not only very difficult, but very expensive. So what we think we're gonna do is actually push Royston into Q1, and we'll drill a follow-up well at Cascadura as our fourth well and the final earning well in the license as we go forward. So we'll go drill Chinook, subject to, you know, where the costs and everything go at Chinook and where world commodity prices are, then the idea would be to move back up and drill what we're calling Cascadura Deep, which is we would take that well down to about 8,500 feet, which is the original target that we had in Cascadura before we had to stop the well. So it'd be great if we could, if that's the plan. So our corporate goals at Ortois, bring Coho on stream. Certainly the first thing we're gonna do is drill that Chinook well. And then, as I mentioned, we'll hopefully move back up to Cascadura. And then we'll start to formulate a plan to bring Cascadura on stream. And quite frankly, if we get a well at Chinook, we'll test Chinook while we're drilling Cascadura. And then we can design all of that pipeline to go up to the gathering system. And then the other thing we're doing is negotiating and formalizing a natural gas contract with NGC. So this is going to be one contract, covers the entire block. And the concept's pretty simple. We're going to deliver all of the gas to NGC. They're going to build all the pipelines into all of our wells that are successful. So that's kind of the trade-off. They'll take all the gas we can give them. And we're just formalizing that. One of the questions I know I'll get is on gas pricing. We do not have gas pricing nailed down yet. We're in the middle of that. We're covered by a CA, so I can't get into too many specifics, but we can certainly look at what some of the other competitors on the island are getting, you know, the EOGs, the Shells, the BPs, and that ranges from 270 per MMBTU to something north of 340 in MMBTU. So give you an idea of the kind of goalposts that we're looking at there. The other thing we have is these development wells on the west side of the island. You know, at current prices, they don't really kick out the rate of returns that we want. So we'll be focusing on the Ortois block, especially with our capital. But we do have 208 locations over there. Oil prices will come back. And these are very, very economic. So we'll just continue to push forward on that. Just to give you some update on first quarter results. We had about $6.6 million USD in sales. Our operating netbacks were $18 a barrel. I had about $1.2 million in funds flow, and that's even with the cratering of oil prices in the final quarter. So actually a fairly good quarter from our point of view. We had a working capital surplus of about $8 million bucks, got about $12 million of cash on hand, and that obviously funds our drilling program for 2020. And then as you bring Coho on and you bring Cascadura on, you start to see free cash flow as we move into 2021. 183 million shares outstanding. That term credit facility you see in the corner, Sarah talked about that. Basically, we found a local bank in Trinidad, one of the largest banks in the Caribbean, that is actually gonna take out that Canadian $20 million facility and replace it with a $20 million US facility. Key components on that is that there's no repayment for a couple of years. There's no covenant review till the end of December of 2022. So, you know, by then we've got the gas on production and away we go. That facility can also be expanded if we decide we need more cash on that side. Just look at the equity returns a little bit comparison. I think it's been, you know, you can see the effect of COVID and the lower oil prices. I think people are starting to get excited again as we move back into the drilling phase. And again, Trinidad has been exceptionally good at managing this crisis. And I think that's going to give us an advantage over some of our competitors coming out the backside of here. But definitely good support from our shareholders, and it's been very positive for us. As far as the environmental stewardship goes, you know, we do a lot of things with our staff down there. We're probably one of the most active in the local area, and we really try to do things locally wherever we can with our staff. And we don't only want to contribute money to what we're doing, but we also want to contribute manpower and help. Two things that we're working on right now, one that I've talked about is water disposal, where we want to get to zero effluents released and re-inject everything, which is above and beyond what is required in Trinidad right now. I think we've got 6 of our 11 properties that are now at zero, and the remainder that we'll hopefully have there by the end of the year. And this is really great. And then the next thing we're moving on to right now is mitigation of natural gas release. In Trinidad, there is a lot of our oil wells, we do have solution gas. So what we want to do is look at ways to gather that, either create use within our operations, re-injecting it into the reservoirs, or creating electricity to run our various pumps. So the first thing we're going to do this year is try to measure the amount of natural gas that we have available to us, and then we'll put in place a plan going forward. of how we use it. And that'll be a big move for us in going forward. Also, you know, that particular one saves us a bunch of money in operating costs. So the team's really focused on that. As far as the leadership goes, a very big crew down there. You know, I think I've made this joke before, but there's a football team up in the corner there. You'll notice the captain of that team there. You might be able to pick them out. The key to winning in these matches in Trinidad is you play the service companies and they'll let you win every time. So we've been pretty successful in winning a few games anyway down there. And then the whole team that we have down in Trinidad, like was mentioned in the earlier presentation, we actually have no expats in country. We use locals for everything. We do bring in the odd contractor when we're looking for expertise on the drilling or completion side, but virtually the whole team is sourced out of Trinidad. So one of the other things that we do, we try to pick a particular project in a particular area that we're operating in, and this would be more out towards our Oratois block. There was a special needs school that needed some additional space. There was an old building right adjacent to them, and again, as I mentioned, not only do we want to supply the money, but we also want to supply the manpower, and we had some great team builders out there to put things together. But I have a whole different respect for everybody that works in Trinidad after you spend a day outside working out in the yard cleaning things up when it's 30 above with 95% humidity. It's really something. So it's great, and I really appreciate everybody that helped us on that project. So that's the investment summary. That's our five key points. The focus is going to be on the exploration side, and we'll just continue to move forward with the program that we have that is fully funded. And we're really excited about getting back in the field in July and getting gas production on in October and Q1 of next year. So company's going to look very, very different in the next 9 months.
But hopefully not too different. Hopefully not too different. Right. I sense your frustration regarding Cascadura. Reservoir data, as you said, was expected at the end of this month. So are you putting to bed any potential of an RNS tomorrow then?
Yeah, no, I can tell you factually, it's not going to be tomorrow. That's the case. We want to get the data right. There's a bunch of data, the two tests. And part of what we want to do is we want to run that through our independent engineering evaluators. We think that it adds credibility, obviously, as opposed to giving you some internal numbers. But it'll also allow us in the gas purchase contract. Part of that gas purchase contract is we have to get a third party to evaluate it so that we get the right type of information. I should caution everybody on that RNS. The one thing the data will show us is it's going to show us two things. It'll show us the minimum pool size, or what size the pool was that we saw in the test. But the most important information that's going to come out of that particular data is what will be the initial production rate for the well, because we'll be able to calculate what the well would do on what's called an AOF, open flow, and then we can take a percentage of that as to what the production rate would be. Those are the two real takeaways. And then I would say 3 to 4 weeks later, we'll have the full engineering report that'll talk about, you know, proven plus probable and reserve. So you get a much better idea of value at that point following that report. But as we've done in the past, as soon as we've got information, we'll fire it up.
Okay, there's lots of, you've already touched on this. Let's re-examine it. Is there any chance, writes one of our participants, that if Chinook is bigger than Cascadura, that you do a second drill at Chinook rather than moving back to Cascadura?
No. I think there's a couple of reasons for that. Number one, we would want to test Chinook before we drilled a second well into it, no matter how good it looked on logs. So we would want to be able to, we'd want to be able to do that for sure. And not only that, you know, Cascadura was like, what we ended up with is unbelievable. But we really, the real target in Cascadura originally was this lower thrust sheet at about 8,000 feet. And we didn't get there in the first well. We still really want to see what's going on, between 6,300 and 8,200 feet in that particular structure. And so it's really important that we get back to Cascadura and drill that next well. I'm, you know, obviously more excited about it now as we did. And, you know, I should caution everybody that these are exploration wells. They're individual structures in each one of them. as we drill them. But we're obviously, you know, the geological team has obviously identified the turbidite fairway. You know, we know where the sands are. Now what we got to do is just take the seismic data and the new drilling information and optimize where we put these wells. We're in a hydrocarbon charged, you know, we're in a hydrocarbon charged fairway. We've got a ready market for these things. Liquids rich natural gas is kind of the mecca of hydrocarbon for us to get. So it's pretty exciting.
Okay, I think that's an understatement. But speaking of drilling, there's a slightly fatalistic question, Paul. What happens if the drill rig breaks? At one time, you said four wells would be drilled in 2019.
Yeah, I think in 2019, we were talking about drilling two wells at Oratoire and then some wells over at our Western block. We just choose from a cash flow point of view that we, and the success we were having at Oratoire, didn't make sense to go drill the oil wells. So we focused on the two wells. And it might be a question that somebody asked. We actually did have a rig failure that caused us to have to sidetrack the well at Cascadura, which obviously made it a lot more expensive. You know, that's just one of the realities of our business is that things can happen when we're drilling. I mean, these are mechanical, these reservoirs are overpressured and they're a challenge. We're gonna try to minimize that by putting what's called a top drive on the unit. We're gonna go to an oil-based drilling system for the next couple of wells, which is number one, environmentally more friendly, but it's also operationally better. But you know, that's why we wanna have the best people there. We're trying to get the crews in place that we have. There are other rigs available on the island. We think this is the best rig suited for this type of purpose. And to be honest with you, we'd probably look for a bigger rig to drill Royston in Q1. And conceptually, although Scott will probably come unglued when I say this, but you know, in a perfect world, what we would do is have this rig drilling Chinook and Cascadura and maybe even a follow-up well at Coho. And then we would have a bigger rig drilling Royston, any follow-ups at Royston in 2021. So you could conceivably, depending on where oil price ends up, you could end up with two rigs going on the Oratoire block and at some point have a third rig drilling up your oil prospects on the west side of the island.
Okay, and with regard to the Oratoire block license, another worst case scenario question, are there any adverse consequences in the event the drilling of the remaining obligation wells is not completed by October due to delays, coronavirus, et cetera? And are there steps that can be taken to manage this risk?
Yeah, that's a big question. First of all, we don't have to have the wells drilled by October. We just have to have the fourth well spudded. So under the current program, that looks like it's gonna happen pretty quickly, so I'm not that worried about it. But there are provisions within the license that once you've made a commercial discovery, which we already have at Coho and Cascadura, you do have the right to extend the lease or license. So we're already there in that regard. At the same time, the Crown down there has been pretty proactive and asked us to, you know, request an additional time period on the initial term as a result of what's happened at COVID. That's not pointed at Touchstone, that's pointed at all the operators on the island. And they put together an executive team to look at this for all the operators on the island. So, you know, this might get taken care of by itself. That wouldn't be a Touchstone solution, that would be a Trinidad solution for all the producers. So I don't think people need to worry about that. One other obligation we do have is we have to shoot some seismic on the block. And we do have that underway in the sense that we've designed it. We know we've got to do it, but it's mostly going to have to be designed around, we're going to do it as a development program. So if, for instance, if we get a successful well at Royston, we'll design a program to help us to define where that field goes. So that's kind of the answer to that one, I think, Sarah.
Okay, and just for people writing into the chat box, you spell Paul's name B-A-A-Y, not B-A-B-Y. Okay, question. Should the TNT resources be found to be game-changing, as hoped, do you see Touchstone remaining primarily an exploration business or moving towards a production business long term?
It's no doubt. We're now moving into a production phase for sure with all these wells that we've had. I mean, you're going to see explosive growth on that side. But you know, we've also had the opportunity during COVID here to kind of step back and say, okay, you know, how many different prospects do we now see at One2One? You know, that number is probably between 14 and 21 prospects that we now see on that One2One block beyond the four wells that we've identified now. So this is now becoming a project. It's becoming a project area that'll have a production base to it. It's going to have cash flow coming off of it. And, you know, we hope at some point that it's got free cash flow coming off, because I don't think, you know, with what we're seeing now, you're going to be able to spend all the money in Trinidad that you're generating in Trinidad. So we'll have to have as a board, sit down and figure out what to do then.
Okay. And finally, in terms of spending money, are there more projects that you can pick up in the current environment?
Yeah, I think the question there is probably even more direct. Is there other opportunities like M&A, like was mentioned in the previous presentation? We had a really good discussion at the board about that back in December. And we think the most valuable thing we can do with our capital right now is just to drill up the One2One block, get it on stream, and focus the team on that. We basically have more than we can manage between the development drilling on the west side of the island when oil comes back, and then what we've got on these projects. So there may be some opportunities that come along, but I don't want the team to be defocused on what we have. We've got a world-class, basically almost offshore-size gas opportunity onshore in a market that needs gas at, you know, reasonably good prices on the gas side of things. We just need to keep put the blinders on and get this across the line for the shareholders.
Okay. Blinders, but not blinkered. Thank you. Paul Bay, really appreciate your time. Time is up, unfortunately, but thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
There's a lot of you out there this evening, 700 across two platforms, across our YouTube platform where we're streaming live. And of course, for those of you who have signed up for this webinar jam. Now, don't forget that with each of the companies that are presenting tonight, you go to the proactiveinvestors.co.uk website and go on to the dedicated homepages for each of these companies, and you will see deep dives and lots of glorious news content. And if you missed the beginning of tonight's event, I'm glad, because I had a technical hiccup. But everyone who's signed up on Webinar Jam will be getting the replay of tonight and the presentations as well. Okay, to our next presenter, who is becoming as ubiquitous as David Buick, the veteran stock market commentator. But the only stock that Cahill Friel is going to be talking about is the one that he is chairman of, Open Orphan. Now, the month of May has been one of great enterprise for Open Orphan, which sees the market cap of the AIM listed company at just over £82 million today. To talk us through the month's developments and what we have to look forward to, we are joined by Cahill. Thank you.
Sarah, it's a pleasure, and thank you very much. And normally I wouldn't have come back as quick, because we last presented a proactive basically 4 or 5 weeks ago, but given we had a substantial fundraise last week, and in between with some very, very substantial news flows, I thought it was time to do an update. Plus, this is the first time we've had our new Open Orphan presentation, bringing all the story together. It's up on our website, and we'll be tweeting that out tomorrow morning. It's available online. Okay. Our disclaimer, as usual, always worth reading. We are in stocks and shares business. I'm bringing my first slide three. Look, I'm not going to dwell, a lot of print, you can read this offline. There's a kind of recurring theme that runs through what I've done with this company and the team. It's kind of a bit of a joke. We've acquired two companies, both had a CEO and some C level, and we've sent lost our CEOs. And we've, again, Trevor Phillips, he was a wonderful CEO of Vivo. He presided over it for the last 3 years. He helped us substantially with the merger. And as you notice from the deck, Trevor is actually leaving us. Now, most people ask, why is that? I think it's still ready. We've agreed that he was unfortunately a casualty of the merger. There was nothing wrong with Trevor, but just our model is basically listed here. We really dive into the companies, we take them, we take out the costs, remove that layer that I think it's exists in too many small cap AM companies, and bring out people like Andrew Catchpole at the very end there. Andrew's been with HP for 14 years. He knows the company better than anybody. And he's our chief scientist. More importantly, he's almost joint head of business development. Likewise in Venn, we have a number of people who've been there for a long time. So the model is, look, take out the costs, get profitable, and we don't layer. I believe we don't need this layer of bureaucracy. I'm a very hands-on executive chairman. This is my third public company I've run, so I think I will manage to keep this one going. Oops, getting used to the slides. There we go. So what have we got? Basically, open offer today. It's now a niche CRO business. It's growing and expected to be profitable real soon. We have a very high margin pharma services business. That is because the hVIVO offering is the world leader in the testing of vaccines and antivirals. And if you're the world leader, why should you sell your offering short? So the margins in hVIVO are between 30 and 40%. That's pretty nice for a services business. It's a simple problem in the past. I had too many, expensive people. The overheads was too high. We've trimmed them out and it didn't have enough contracts. So it was an expensive cost base and not enough business. And you'll see in a moment, we're making sure cost base is reducing rapidly and we're adding a lot more business. And that gives us leverage to hopefully make a lot of money in the year and years ahead. We have a broad customer base, including global pharma companies. And more importantly, you'll see in the next slide or two, we have virtually every vaccine pharma company in the world, either as existing, current customers, or recent past ones. That's a pretty nice niche. Very importantly, we have several new revenue streams started. We don't want to be a one-trick pony. We're purely challenge studies. You've seen we've started antibody testing. We're going to do lab testing. And that's the secret to these companies. Make sure we don't. We're substantial and we have a rapidly growing pipeline. Quick overview. I know quite a few have seen this already. I'm not going to dwell too much, other than we've now a very complementary businesses. hVIVO is a unique cash flow positive business, large upfront cash payments that we get on signing and regular amounts. So basically, cash flow positive means we're not funding the business, so it starts to fund itself quite well. We did need to raise some money to bolster our balance sheet. I'll come to that in a few minutes. We have this clinic in East London. Bear in mind, hVIVO did raise 113 million and we acquired it for 10p in the pound 13. We did get left a lot of assets, but look, it's a pretty exciting business to have at the moment. Likewise, Venn, the really important part here is in the blob, we've slimmed down the Paris operation. We're focusing now on what we're good at, data management, services, biostats, randomization. And again, look at the customer base. You have Janssen, which is the vaccine arm of Johnson & Johnson, one of the leading COVID developers in the world. Boehringer Ingelheim, second biggest German company. You have DARPA, the American Defense Organization. Gilead, we all hear about in the press. We have Merck, Ipsen. So basically, a lot of these companies you're hearing about in the press are actually existing customers of the combination of hVIVO and Venn. Quick snapshot of what we have today. We only did our IPO last year. There's now 549 shares in issue. Shares in issue post raise, we have 12 million fundraise and there's now only 658. Market cap is 83 million. Cash in the balances pre-fundraise is 2.3. Cash balances on the 12th of June will be 14.3. Net debt 1.4. And quick roundup of revenues last year. This is the amalgamation of both hVIVO and Venn, 24 million. Gross profit 3.8. And normalized EBITDA, look at that, it's an outrageous figure for both these companies last year, negative 9 million. We have now eliminated, if you look at that, implemented in 2009, the cost 3.4, implemented this year 4.5, and implemented by December. So we've taken out 10 million of the costs. So even we didn't add a single penny to revenue this year, we'd be making 1.1 million. And you'll see in a minute we intend to add a lot more than 1 million to the existing year's revenues. I think the rest self-explanatory. The very important thing, we have a nice shareholder base. It'll be even better in a few weeks with substantial institutions. I invested 2 million of my own money. I've got, and the other founders, don't forget, we've 20% between us, or 19.9. We're locked up for 3 years. Invesco, 9.56. They're assuring us they're going to stay with us. And the Link Funds, Woodford Fund, 7.3. I gather those funds are no longer, they'll be staying with us for a lot longer at that stake. Post the merger, there's the 17th of January, we put these two businesses together. And bear in mind, the 17th of January, nobody wanted to know that good old HVivo, based here in East London, Whitechapel, was the world leader in developing vaccines, testing them, and antivirals. Even my own 12-year-old kid now seems to know what antivirals are. It's amazing what can happen in 3 months. So let's be frank, we're brave and bold. We moved very fast, but we also got lucky to have picked up a business nobody wanted, but now the world wants to know about it. We said we'd integrate the business, we'd reduce the cost base, we'd expand the laboratory services, very important. We'd convert the HVivo pipeline and we get profitable. What have we done? Say we're a group of people in a reasonable hurry. We've completed all of the above, 2 million of the cost base from HVivo already in 3 months, 3 million of the vent cost base since 17th of January, and a further 2.5 to come out. We will be operationally profitable by Q3. We've right-sized the management team. I say unfortunately, our mythology is we do lose CEOs and we don't replace them. We think that most of these companies, there's absolutely wonderful. And our trick is finding those wonderful people like Andrew Catchpole and others who've been there a long time, who are hard workers, and they get on with the job. Quick snapshot, 6th of March, 3.2 million pilot RSV study. That started immediately and to be done within 6 months. And that's followed on by immediately a 7 million pivotal study later this year. A lot of that revenue, the 7 million flow in this year, but the deal will be booked. So there, in one fell swoop, we got a more or less 10 million contract in our hand. We'll come more to the 9th of March. That was transformational. And this is going to be a lot of news in the coming weeks, the coronavirus challenge study. Expanded, this is really important. We expanded the third party pharma services, the lab, to biotechs who don't have labs and other smart enforcement is near medic. We've found a very willing appetite. Lots of small mid-cap pharma companies very keen to use our labs. So you'll see a lot more on the laboratory service. 4th of May, another 3.5 million RSV study kicks off. That's be done almost right away, be finished in the coming months. And then we're all wanting to hear more. We'll talk about the COVID antibody testing. And again, genuinely, sometimes you get lucky. Some people worry. We've these antibody tests is 100% accuracy. They're full blood draws, only three companies. People would feel the pinprick ones would be competitive. And guess what? Just yesterday, the MHRA asked fingerprint prick people to stop it, that they're not accurate and they're leading to, so that's basically taken out most of our competition. And now the market is left to ourselves, Roche and the Abbott kits, as the only three types of tests in the UK and Ireland that can guarantee 100% accuracy. Again, that is being genuinely lucky. We didn't see that one coming. Really important, the two big things you're going to hear a lot in the coming weeks and months is the COVID-19 opportunity. So guess what, folks, for all of us who are worrying about COVID, it will be fixed. It's probably going to take a lot longer. Today, there's over 100 COVID-19 vaccines in development around the world. Being honest, there's only really 20 genuine ones, and you know the names, the Modernas, the Oxford one, the J&J, etc. Of those 20 serious players, we're in a really lucky position. We're in a dialogue with 12 of them. Those 12 are asking HVivo, can you folks hurry up and test our vaccine? Does it have efficacy? The really interesting part about it is, traditionally, you would go out to the community to test the vaccine, does it work? You might infect or vaccinate 10,000 people and see if it works. Given that COVID has now been snuffed out in a lot of parts of the world, it's very hard to test a vaccine. And our belief is the only way COVID manufacturers around the world will bring it to the market anytime soon is do a challenge study. And we're in the odd position of being one of the few companies in the world who can do a COVID-19. So just do the numbers there. If 12 of those developers sign up, we're intending to charge in the region of 7 million per study. So the very simple sums, that's 80 plus million contracts we could lead this year. They're not in the bag, so let's not factor them in. People say, how the hell are you going to do them? Well, basically with this quarantine clinic, it's zoned very lot of foresight. It's in three zones of 8, so we can run three competitive vaccines at the same time. But bear in mind, there's a huge interest at governmental level across Europe. And I think we will be expanding on a temporary basis our capability very, very soon. The average study takes 2 to 4 months in the clinic if we're doing multiples of them. But the beauty about within 2 to 4 months, we can guarantee any COVID-19 vaccine, does your vaccine work or not? That's a pretty bold statement to be able to make. So it's a nice place to be. And it's great, being honest with you. It's for the first time in my life, I think, and the HVFO and Up North team will be able to look back in years to come and say, wow, we think we were able to help humanity by speeding up a multiple of vaccines. Bear in mind, this is not a winner takes all. There won't be a single. This is not Mr. Trump style winner takes all. There's going to be a number in North America vaccines, a number of European ones, a number of Asian ones, a number of Chinese ones. We intend to test them all and get paid for it and do it really fast. I'm not going to dwell on this one. Basically, the Chinese study model is a way of testing, does a vaccine work? Conscious of time, I'm going to flick through that. It's there for anybody who wants to read it. Really importantly, page 10, how is all this business of our antibody going to work? Basically, we've acquired one machine that can handle 3,000 tests per day. We can get a second one if necessary. There's only two other companies in the UK, that's Roche and the Abbott, that can give the 100% testing. And I know I saw some questions, can we have the resources? Absolutely, we can scale up on a contract basis. We're not going to start hiring tons of staff. The beauty about the machine, you can see it there, third picture over on the bottom from the left. It's robotic, it needs two technicians. You switch it on in the morning, it takes half an hour to warm up, and then every 30 seconds, it completes one test. It's generally run 24-hour cycles. That our lab runs 24/7 because we're constantly testing blood samples for the clinic. So the two technicians can run it. But I know some people were concerned, have we the capability? Absolutely, we have both the capability and the resources. But we will be making a major press launch in the next week or so as regards that that facility will be open for business. We're not waiting for weeks and weeks. We're days away from going live on that. And again, just sometimes people have a bad run and have had plenty of bad runs in the last couple of years. And then suddenly in the last 6 months, we're having a really, really lucky run. The fact that people were getting confused with the pinprick ones, which are not 100% testing, and the pinprick ones, the regulator in the UK asked them to withdraw them from the market because they're causing inaccurate tests, where we can absolutely assert, and we've put up there, we are 100% accurate. We're really targeting this at the large employer groups. This is not a consumer product, and we want to do be able to tell the Goldman Sachs, the JP Morgan, Citibank, test every one of the staff on a fortnightly basis, and who can go back in and who's to stay working from home. Very importantly, I know a lot of you don't forget, we have this database, and we're HVAVO has a treasure trove of data, and our plan is to now port a lot of that data into a genomic database and make it available on a subscription basis to large pharma companies from later this year. So that's a very exciting. I know a lot of people thought with all the excitement, it's like having an annoying big brother. This is the little brother, and the antibody testing was like the big brother, and also the COVID-19 test. But this little brother hasn't gone away and is just getting warmed up. And that's the genomic database. This is a really important slide. The problem with poor old HVAVO in the past, it has these fabulous facilities, fabulous staff, but its break-even point. It didn't have enough work to justify it. The beauty about the fixed cost base, when you break through that, and we're intending not alone breaking through it, but smashing through it would be the word we'd use for this year. And once you break through that break-even point, you start throwing off cash. A big part of it was we had to lower the break-even point by removing excess overheads, one could say excess baggage. But no, there's wonderful people in it, and just sometimes there's not enough room for them in our business plan. Current trading, we've HVAVO has a very strong pipeline of results to build H2 2020 revenue and forecast to build into 21. HVAVO contract wins, we've gone through them. Venn is trading in line with last year. We're not looking to really build up Venn. Venn is a fabulous, steady eddy business. It's never going to develop 20 or 30 or 40 million revenues. That's the revenue growth that, all going well, we can focus out of HVAVO. But it's a wonderful business. We've never got HVAVO out of Venn. And Venn services now all our contracts going forward, the data management, the biostats, medical writing are supplied by Venn. And that's a gross margin win. So it's a really, we're acting and behaving like a really integrated company. pipeline. This, look at this. We have a pipeline now. In January, it was basically 110. We've now increased the HVFO pipeline. It was actually, sorry, in January, it was actually 100. We've increased it by 20% to now 110. And the blue sky, I know we warn people, this is the blue sky, but we're trying to be conservative on the bottom. The blue sky, we're saying we've opportunities, the COVID-19 challenge study. If we can get a working attenuated virus or a real deal wild style COVID-19, and we think we're getting there, we put in there 35 to 70 million in incremental revenue that hasn't been backed in. That's the opportunity. Again, I emphasize, people, blue sky is in color of the blue sky. We need to be careful. Till we get that challenge study model working, we shouldn't bank that 35 or 70. But if we get it working, we are the only place in the world can test all those vaccines and tell people to work or not. Third-party pharma COVID, we're trying to be very modest here. Five to 10 million, that's the third party of our laboratory services, third party. Absolutely, that's coming through rather nicely. And then rollout, we're being very conservative, 10 to 30 million. Let's see where that all goes. We're going to have a large press launch in the coming week or 10 days. Hopefully remain very lucky in that space. But again, emphasize, the light blue is the blue sky. That's the upside. I never thought in a million years when we put these companies together in January that we'd be looking at opportunities like that and near term. Not boring on that one. That's a huge global awareness of what we're doing. We have 50,000 registered volunteers who are mad keen to engage. And this is a huge asset. They've registered the great British patriotism of wanting to help out. On a normal week, we get maybe 30, 40 volunteers signing up. We've had over 50,000 volunteers sign up since we announced we're going to do a COVID challenge study.
You've got 1 minute left.
Perfect. Thanks, Sarah. I'm going to swiftly let that one speaks for itself. This one, last thing, last couple of days, you'll see Merck acquired a small Austrian company called Themis. It's almost exact same as Immutex. The figure hasn't been, merger market says somewhere between 100 million and 500 million. Hopefully we'll find out soon. But Themis is very similar to Immutex. We own 49% of it. We're making clear that stake, and we're going to try and put it together with the 51% and spin it off, put it into a larger vehicle. But the fact that a nearest virtually similar company got bought for very substantial money by Merck this week tells you Immutex is something. We also have Prep Pharma. And as you will see, if not, they're non-core. The core is to the right, and the non-core, I think we can put together. If we don't sell them off for a large cash consideration, which will be refunded to all shareholders in a dividend species, we don't intend to hold on to this cash. But that's got even more exciting. And I didn't see Merck coming out of left field to acquire Themis. So Novartis, if you're watching, how about doing the same for us? I think every shareholder would be very happy to see a very large dividend paid out of Immutex changed hands sometime soon. I think, Sarah, on that point, I'm open for questions, and I probably have to deal with questions about our fundraise last week, as I'm sure a lot of people are asking questions.
Yeah, I'm quite sure that Novartis is watching, actually. There are so many questions. Just to let you know, if your questions aren't asked within this forum, all the questions go to all our presenters, so the presenters will see all the questions asked. So I'm going to start off with in summary, question, Cahill. Is the company going to be sold at the end of the year as originally planned? And Cahill, has his end game now changed, and what is he now targeting and what timescales?
Sir, I'm glad you asked that question. The beauty of this, I can watch down as the questions come in so we can bundle some of them together. Yeah, look, when I put this company together earlier this year, we acquired HV for over 13 million in all equity. The combined was 30. I thought 3 times that would be a sensible valuation. I certainly didn't see antibody testing coming out of left field. I absolutely did not. Nobody saw COVID-19 coming. So no, we're not for sale at 100 million. I don't think anybody around the table is going to take 100 million. We're always for sale, Novartis. If you want a piece of us, you can have the Immutex, whatever the price is worth. But no, look, I think we have to crack the whip and say, if we don't say we're selling, people get complacent. We're not new, we're being complacent. Everything's for sale, but absolutely not. No, the valuation has to be much, much higher than 100 million. I certainly have no interest in selling that, but I'm not going to be in this company. I'm in this company to return value to shareholders, and the biggest one of them being myself. So it's definitely for sale. Maybe not as soon as expected. I think we have a possibility to get the company now to be substantially higher valuation, potentially a multiple of where we currently are in a relative short period in time. If we deliver even half of what we're planning, we're worth an awful lot more than the current. So I don't want to be saying given guidance and share prices. I know in recent weeks people complained I was talking it down. I was just trying to get some steadiness. We don't want to go stratospheric up and back down. We want to build this company steady, incremental steps. And let's watch the news flow in the coming weeks and people can make up their mind. Is it worth substantially more? I think absolutely. I think we're about to, we've only started, and we've a lot more to do. And it will be hopefully a lot getting even more exciting in the weeks and months ahead.
Okay, now in terms of the share price, what effect do you expect on the current share price when the placing shares come on the market tomorrow? And what are the plans for that extra cash raised?
Yeah, look, we have, you'll have seen for a presentation, we were down to about 2 million before the fundraise. We are now dealing with the top 5, top 10, top 12 pharmaceutical companies in the world who have multi-tens of billions on their balance sheet. So we felt having 5, 10 million on our balance sheet puts us in a much better position. Look, there was an opportunity to raise it because we think if we're looking of a potentially 100 million extra in revenue, potentially is all over the coming year, we do need a bit of cash to avail of them. We could have just held tight. So I think that cash will be used very wisely. We intend keeping a good chunk in the balance sheet. The business here today forward is producing cash. There's no more of those days of losing money, please sir, more. Pretty exciting. Watch this space.
Okay, so we learned today that if you live in Scotland, you can soon start bowling and playing tennis. But has the government in Scotland been on the phone to you, Cahill?
Sarah, adopting a slightly different model, and again, it's because we want to move fast. We're leaving Rush to deal with the governments of Britain and Ireland, and we're reaching out directly to employer groups. So if any large employer groups in Scotland wants all the staff tested within 24 hours immediately, we have arrangements going in place with nursing groups throughout the UK, GP groups to test them. So no, our model is to go out to employer groups. It's a B2B. Unfortunately, we're not geared up to do people directly, but we will be announcing in the coming weeks a series of GP networks, health clinic networks, and employer groups. So what we want to do is prove to employers who is antibody positive or negative, and that allows those people to go back to work. And the view is a lot of employers want to do that at least once a month. They'll be back to us every month to retest and retest.
Okay, what has happened? This from Alan Dorling. What has happened to the malaria product publication in The Lancet? Is that due very soon? Are you proofreading anything that we will all see soon?
Yeah, look, again, talk about getting lucky, having both a universal flu vaccine and a universal mosquito vaccine on our books. That is certainly on its way. These things, is it 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks? We're assured it will be published. That's the results of the phase one. And I don't think The Lancet would be publishing something that doesn't publish good results. So that's work in progress. Watch that space.
Okay, this is a pretty decent question, which is, you know, if we reach that zero rate in terms of COVID deaths, then is that going to make your COVID testing aspirations redundant?
No, I think it's very clear. Look, COVID is the most nasty, unpleasant thing any of us experience in our life. I think any of our children experience in our life. However, it's clear there's no immediate cure for it. It's clear the only cure is vaccines. And they say there's 100 in development. I think Trump and people who are saying the vaccine will be here late this year are telling lies. It's going to take a long time to get working vaccines. There's going to be multiples of them. And I think, unfortunately, there's going to be probably seasonal COVID issues. So I think, look, where we're sitting, we're very excited. I've been frank. We're just bloody lucky. Look, no matter how we could have planned, we couldn't have planned this. We're sitting in COVID Central, but we still have are really steady. Even COVID disappeared tomorrow. We have an RSV challenge study business, a flu challenge study business, and several other ones that are starting to really produce the business for us. So we're not purely COVID, but we're COVID transformational, I would say. That answers your question.
Okay, so you've just said that you're bleeding lucky. I'm just thinking about the luck of the Irish. Alan Tonner says, looking at the 12 deals on the table for HVivo, how many of these deals are you likely to win?
All of them. Genuinely, there's nobody else can test them. Look, to test a vaccine, there's two ways. You go out and vaccinate tens of thousands of people, and you wait, and you wait, and you hope some of them get the disease, and that's the way you test, does a vaccine work. That can take months, usually years. Or otherwise, a challenge study, you bring them into the clinic where we vaccinate them all, and then we actually ensure every one of them get the disease, all 100 of them. So we guarantee within a short period of time, we can tell people when 100%, it's a bit like an antibody testing, when 100% efficacy, does your vaccine work or not? So at the moment, there's absolutely nobody else in the world has stated its intention. There was only one other company that did challenge studies. It was a small European competitor, but it was owned by a 20 billion Swiss monster, and they've declared they're not doing it. They don't want to dabble in the space. We're small and innovative. We can move fast. So we think if all goes well, some of the vaccine developers won't bother with the challenge study, but we think quite a lot of them will be on our books. And we clearly said of the 20 genuine vaccine developers, 12 of them are at our table in discussions.
Okay, looking at beyond the UK, it's a bit of a rhetorical question here from Virginia. She says, you previously mentioned looking for a cash shell for presumably a reverse takeover in the States. So I think that she's asking is, are you still considering that?
Yeah, sir, absolutely. Look, this is our non-core assets. And again, I just mentioned the Merck acquisition of Themis. It's an Austrian Vienna-based vaccine company. If you look at it, it's got a series of vaccines, exact same stage of development as us. It's almost a mirror image of what we have. So Merck have decided to go that route. We believe our Immutex is valuable, if not more valuable than that Austrian company. So we've got multiple options. We've got to consult with our 51% shareholder. We're 49, but I think both shareholders, the 51, who's the C group, and us, have made it clear we have a strategic review. We're trying to monetize that. One of them, if Novartis or somebody came over the field and offering us a very large check, of course we'll sell. We're not going to sell it for a bad price. Or we can put it all into a shell and monetize that way, because then we have, as you'll see from page 18, we have a series of other assets we can put 100% together that are in the vaccine influenza space, and we very quickly could have a very exciting vaccine company listed in Nasdaq. We've done as a dividend species, regardless what happens, the results from Intex will be paid out to all shareholders equally as a dividend species. So we're not intend raising any money for that, but we do intend monetizing it this year.
Okay, so you ended your presentation on Immutex. This is going to be the final question from us to you. It's actually from Aftab, who says, what's the timescale for a spin-off of Immutex?
Soon. We don't know. That's being facetious. Look, when a monster like Merck acquires a company very similar and you happen to own 49% of it, it does give you options. So I think, look, as you know, we don't hang around. This Immutex situation, we'd call it, is non-core. It's a product company. We're services. We're profitable. It needs to be dealt with over the coming, is that months? Yes, it's months, not years. It's not weeks. It's not possible, but certainly it's exciting. And I think last week's fundraising, though, I got some flack for it. I think our current share price at the moment, I would feel very comfortable. We've substantially, anybody who came in on it and anybody who missed it, we've a long way to go from here. That Immutex spin-off is only part of the story. It's transformational. The antibody testing is transformational. The COVID-19 testing is transformational. And further RSV studies coming down the track will be transformational. So we're in a lucky position of having four transformational product lines. Even if we get one of them right, we'll do well. And why not go for four? Always try and go for too much and see can we pull it all off.
Okay, now I'm not accusing you of being a corporate control freak, but what's the likelihood at the end of June that you will become chief executive of Open Orphan again and relinquish your chairmanship, or perhaps keep both titles?
Sarah, I think being a CEO of a company I'm involved is a dangerous role. They don't last very long. I think, under the AIM rules, it's very clear. You can have a CEO and a non-exec chairman, or an executive chairman, and there's no need for a CEO. I believe there's absolutely wonderful people now in both companies, in Venn and HVivo. We've put them together, and I intend remaining very hands-on, full-time capacity, for till we put the company in safe hands. Is that a trade sale, or is that when it's many multiples bigger, one or the other? So that I don't think there's need for any aspiring CEOs returning up. If there's a CEO going to come, it'll come from within the company. And there is people who could fill that role amply. So, but I think there's no rush. We're not looking to fill any roles externally. I think there's fantastic staff, and it's actually great motivation when we're coming in. We are a bit of a hatchet people, being honest with you. But for the remaining staff, it's nice to see, well, look, if you play with us and deliver results, we're not going to bring any helicopter people on top of you.
Remind me never to work for you, Cahill. Thank you very much indeed. Time's up. Thank you very much for your contribution.
Much Sarah, appreciated. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, well, to our final presentation of the evening, and it's Horizonte Minerals, AIM listed with a market cap of £54 million. Now, it owns sizable nickel projects in Brazil, and over the past few months, it has undertaken sizable humanitarian measures to assist those afflicted by COVID-19 in Brazil. To find out if the company is on track and not delayed, we're joined by the Chief Executive, Jeremy Martin.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here this evening, and thank you everybody who's joined the presentation tonight. A number of you will have obviously heard of the company before, but for those of you who haven't, we are a exploration company or development company focused in Brazil. We're dual listed. We're on the AIM in London, on the main TSX in Toronto. And our focus as a business is to become a significant nickel producer. We have two tier one nickel projects in Brazil that we own 100% of. The Araguaia ferronickel project is a project that we've discovered and then consolidated with acquisitions from other major companies, taking it through a feasibility study, and we're now working on the financing to start construction of that project. And then we have a second asset called the Vermelho Nickel Cobalt project, and that creates a district scale nickel play. We're in a very good jurisdiction. We're in a mining region. We've got good infrastructure. And Horizonte provides you direct exposure to nickel. And I'll talk about the types of nickel and where we sit in that arena. We're well funded. We've got around 17 million in cash in the company today. And this whole story is scalable. We've got the ability with our asset base to build a very significant nickel producer. So that's the introduction to the company. Looking at where we're at, the map on the screen there shows our region in northeastern Brazil. The areas in yellow towards the top of that map are all producing mines by the major company Vale. They're either copper or iron ore. And this region is called the Carajás mining region, and it is one of the world's major mining regions. Our projects are shown in red, which is the Vermelho project. In the center of that map, ANN, is the Araguaia North cluster of assets that we acquired from Glencore. And then to the south of that map, we've got the main Araguaia hub itself. And why this is so unique is we see the potential to build the first mine at Araguaia, which is the two blue factory symbols, the second mine at Vermelho in the north. All of these deposits are within trucking distance of each other. And between those two mines, you've got the ability to produce 50 to 60,000 tons of nickel a year. And that would be broadly in line with what Anglo American is producing today. So it is a very big scale opportunity we have here. And we own 100% of this. The other key thing about this region.
Jeremy, your presentation slides aren't moving along. Are you able to flip through them? your end?
Yeah, I think we're on the same slide at the moment. Is that right?
We're on the front page of your presentation.
It's moved along for me.
Okay. So do you want to tell me when to move the slides on?
Yeah, let's do that. So we're on the second page now.
Second page. Okay. So I've got cautionary statements, and then I've got multi-asset nickel company.
And we're now on scalable production. So I'm on page 4, which is scalable production.
Okay, so whenever you want me to go on to the next page, just let me know and I'll do that.
Perfect. So we're just finishing off on this slide. Really the key thing about this region is the infrastructure. It's got hydroelectric power, roads, rail, and that makes the whole journey towards being a producer much simpler and lower cost. This is our journey. Moving to the next slide. This shows our resource growth over the last 7 or 8 years. So from our initial discovery in 2010, 2012, we then acquired from an adjacent discovery made by Canada's largest mining company, Teck, then from Glencore, and then 18 months ago, we acquired the Vermelho project from Vale. So this has been a pretty significant growth in our asset base. And all of these deals have been done really at the lower end of the nickel price market. And just to support that 50,000 to 60,000 tonne a year nickel potential, Glencore at its deposit was going to produce 42,000 tonnes of nickel a year. Vale at Vermelho were going to produce 46,000 tonnes. And at the Teck Horizonte area, we can produce 30,000 tonnes. So it is substantiated by some of the largest mining companies in the world. Moving to the next slide and into the nickel market. So on page 7, hopefully everybody's caught up. This is really just talking about why nickel is such an interesting space to be in. And there are 3 or 4 key fundamentals. Nickel's main use today is stainless steel. You will have used it in pretty much everything that you've in your everyday existences, whether it's knives and forks or pipework that brought your water. It is a fundamental metal in our lives. And that is growing at around 3 to 4% year on year. The second large demand driver, which is something that has really come into the marketplace very aggressively in the last 3 or 4 years, is the electric vehicle market. And this is set to significantly expand over the next 10 to 20 years. And nickel is a main constituent in the EV battery cathode. And that really will add a significant new demand driver into the business. And we also had the LME stocks have been drawn down over the last 7 or 8 years. And we're now at a point where we're at a low point in the cycle in terms of metal stocks. And the other factor is because the nickel price has been really depressed for the last 7 to 10 years, there's been very little money has flown into the next generation of nickel projects. And if you're not developing your project today, the timeline to take an exploration project through to production is anywhere between 8 to 10 years. And UBS did some interesting research. They looked at 40 of the global nickel projects that are either development stage, on care and maintenance, or restarts. And half of those projects only provided a 15% internal rate of return at $20,000 a ton nickel. And we're trading at $12,000 today. So it shows that most of those projects will not come online in the short term. Moving on to the next page. This just highlights that stainless steel sector. The inner ring there on the pie chart really shows that 70% of all nickel goes into stainless steel today. And for battery use, it's around 3 to 4% today. However, if you look forward to 2040, which is really the main sort of penetration and measure point that people are using with EV vehicles, the stainless steel arena will have reduced to around 38 to 40%, and the EV piece will have increased up towards 45%. So it's going to be a major demand driver. And moving on to the next slide, this just shows what the market balance will look like over that period. So sort of halfway along that graph, 2020, we're in a relatively balanced environment today. But as you move out towards 2025 and 2030, you can see the existing supply, which is the gray area at the bottom of the graph, is starting to level off, whereas the demand curve in blue is increasing. And then as you run out to 2040, there is a very significant gap between what's being produced and what the market is going to need. And to put that into context, this year we're going to produce around 2.3 to 2.4 million tons of nickel. The EV market alone in the next 15 to 20 years is going to need somewhere around 1 to 1.5 million tons of nickel on its own. So effectively another third on what we're producing today. And over that same period, there's going to be another million tons required for the stainless market. So it's a very interesting marketplace. And we feel today we are very well positioned with our two assets to capitalize on that growing market going forwards. Next slide, please. So moving on to our Araguaia ferronickel project. This is the asset that we are currently moving towards construction. This slide shows the economics from the feasibility study based upon a long-term nickel price of $16,400 a tonne. And you can see there it generates some fairly significant returns, an NPV of $690 million. It pays the capital back in 3 years. And the key number is the cost of producing that nickel will be just under $7,000 a tonne, which makes it lower quartile, one of the lowest next generation nickel producers. And again, if you look at today's nickel price, that means you would be making significant returns even at the low nickel prices we're seeing today. The next slide just shows how we compare with other ferronickel operations in South America. And the table on the right just shows these assets. We're at the top there, Araguaia, and it's all about the nickel grade. You can see there our average grade for the 28-year mine life is around 1.7% nickel. And the other assets, Cerro Matoso in Colombia, operated by South 32, Onça Puma by Vale, and then the two Anglo-American operations are significantly lower grade. And for the first 10 years of our mine life, we'll be around 2% nickel. And in mining, it's all about high grade, low cost, which Araguaia is. Moving on to the next slide, which just shows the process plant. This will be what we're starting construction on later this year. It's a very good location for a process plant. You can see on the right hand side there, it's flat cattle grazing countryside, low population density. And that's a relatively compact plant site. And the key thing is it's designed for expansion. So that area with the blue outline will be where we put the second line in, the second process line, and have the ability to double our nickel production from 14,000 tons a year up to nearly 30,000 tons a year, which would be a tier one nickel project or nickel mine. Infrastructure, as I said earlier on the next slide, slide 14 is very good. We'll be using the existing port into the north of the state, Villa de Conde. We've got existing state roads, hydroelectric power, and our town where we have our offices, Concesado Araguaia, is a town of 45,000 people. It's 20 kilometers from the project and has a good service center and will be where we source and base our workforce. Next slide is the flow sheet. We're using a technology called rotary kiln electric furnace, and this produces a product called ferronickel, which goes straight into the stainless steel market. And the key thing about this process is it's well proven. There are over 40 mines using it around the world today, and all of those pieces of equipment are mainstream and have multiple producers where we can source from. So it is low risk. And in terms of the product on the next slide, this is the little image there next to the sort of the cube. Those are ferronickel pellets, and that's exactly what we will be producing. It grades around 30% nickel. It leaves site either in one-ton bags or containers, and then is sold directly to the stainless steel producers. So it's a very highly refined product that leaves site. We're construction ready on the next slide. We got our construction license last year. We are fully permitted to start construction. We have a very good level of social engagement around the project. Our ESG programs have been rolled out over the last 2 years. And also we've been operating in this region now for 10 years. So we are very well known in the community. And the community sees this as a major project for growth in that part of the state. It's an over a 30-year mine life. it'll be a major employer and will be a major driver for growth and economic development. Next slide. So we're currently working through a period of value engineering on the ground, and that's really taking the feasibility study through to being construction ready. And you can see there all the work streams. It's basically going out to market. We're just about to release all of the packages to the vendors to work through final pricing and negotiation of equipment packages, award of the engineering contract to the main contractor to construct the project, and all of the work streams that go into that. And this is a fairly large undertaking, as well as staffing up on our side, so that effectively when we close the project financing, we're able to start construction. Next slide. This is a quick snapshot of the cash flow generation of Araguaia, and this will be a significant cash flow generative asset. Over its life of mine, it generates over $2.5 billion of free cash flow. And on an annual basis, it'll generate about $150 million of profit a year. So it is something that has the ability to generate significant cash, pay dividends, and allow us to expand the business. On to the next slide. Late last year, we signed an exciting transaction, which was a royalty with one of the large or the world's largest mining private equity firm, Orion Mine Finance. And we signed a revenue royalty for $25 million payable up front for a 2.25% royalty on Araguaia. It was quite a neat transaction. It is limited to the stage one nickel that we produce. And the key thing about this transaction, we had three or four other deals on the table at the time. And the reason we went with Orion is they don't typically just play in the royalty space. They want to be involved in the full financing of these projects. And we see them being a key part of the equity component of the project finance. And there are ongoing discussions with Orion as we speak. Talking about the construction financing, we are well advanced with this process. We have five international banks as part of the debt syndicate. We had site visits earlier in the year, luckily pre the COVID outbreak. We've got three local banks, also part of the debt syndicate, and we have two European ECAs. So between those groups, that will cover the debt portion of the project financing. And we are also well advanced on the equity financing to make up the balance of the project finance. So for all the pieces of the project finance transaction, we have multiple live groups, and that process is moving along schedule. And we're aiming to have that closed as we move into the latter part of Q3, early Q4. Then we move on to our second asset, the Vermelho Nickel Cobalt asset, and that's just a screenshot there, that photo showing the two deposits. We acquired this from Vale, and they'd spent over $200 million on it, and it is one of the largest, highest grade, undeveloped nickel cobalt projects in the world today. And the reason we were so excited by this transaction is it's very high grade, and it's within trucking distance of Araguaia. Moving to the next slide, Vale actually gave the construction go ahead to this project in 2005. We took the Vale feasibility study. Theirs was for a much larger scale of project, much larger capex, and we re-engineered it. And late last year, we released a pre-feasibility study. And you can see there, it is a significantly larger project than Araguaia. Over the 30-year mine life, it generates over $7 billion of free cash flow. And again, key driver here, it's going to be low cash cost. It's going to be one of the lowest cost operations out there. The next slide just shows how it compares globally. This is a grade tonnage curve. And whichever way you want to plot Vermelho, whether it's grade of nickel, contained nickel, it can outperform the majority, if not all of its peer group globally. And I will say that's nothing that we've done. This was a tier one asset that Vale were going to develop themselves. So our pathway for Vermelho is we've completed the pre-feasibility. We've just awarded the contract to advance the environmental permitting. And then we will take the project through to feasibility over the next 24 months. The next slide just shows the cost curve where we sit. And this is a nickel laterite cost curve. And again, both Vermelho and Araguaia will be some, if not the lowest cost next generation of nickel cobalt projects in the marketplace going forwards. ESG and sustainability is a key part of our drive as we develop the projects. And with Araguaia, we've got a number of work streams underway looking at reducing CO2, reducing water, building and developing community partnerships. And we see that as part of allowing us and our social license to operate. And one of the key things we're seeing from off-takers we're talking to is they're all focused on what is the CO2 content of your ferronickel. And our aim is to be, again, one of the lowest CO2 cost or CO2 generative sources for next generation ferronickel. Next slide. Just go through this slide quickly. Obviously, COVID has had an effect on what we're doing. It's Brazil is suffering very heavily from COVID as we speak. We've effectively been able to continue work streams. We have had to slow down one or two areas. But we've also put a large focus on supporting our communities around the projects through food parcels, advice in terms of ensuring that we're giving the right advice medically and being able to really support those communities around our project. Next slide. So really, just to conclude, our focus is to become a major nickel producer. Araguaia will move through, and our aim is to have financing closed on the project later this year, allowing us to start construction and take the project through to being a tier one ferronickel producer. In parallel, we will be advancing our Vermelho nickel cobalt project through to feasibility study, and that allows us to supply all parts of the nickel market. Araguaia for ferronickel for the stainless market, which is real and growing today, and then Vermelho to service the new electric vehicle market as that expands and becomes an everyday piece of our existence. Finally, the last slide, we have a strong group of shareholders led by Teck Resources, Canada's largest mining company. We also have Glencore on the register, a number of London institutions, and you can see their market cap, cash position, and obviously where we do the majority of our trading. So it's a very exciting time for the company. Over the next 6 months, we expect a number of major milestones to be delivered as we move through the financing and start construction. And also, the nickel market is really aligned for our journey as we move to be a producer. And I think if you look at the current consensus price forecast across 20 of the major banks, their long-term forecast is around $16,000 a ton. And obviously our C1 cost is around $7,000 a ton. So these really are high quality, low cost assets. So that's a summary of the Horizonte story, and look forward to keeping you updated and open for questions.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. Thomas, can you go back to slide 9, please? We'll just have a look at the graph for the price of nickel or the supply demand graphic. You said, Jeremy, that that nickel is a good place to be in now, but looking at that graph, it's also going to be a great place in the future as well. And bearing that in mind, one of the questions that we've had is, are you concerned the leveling of the nickel supply curve and likely rising price will drive EV battery tech to find an alternative?
Interesting question. I think, well, obviously Araguaia is focused, and that was always our driver. We wanted to deliver a mine and a product that was real, and we didn't have to wait for a future growth market. So Araguaia will produce ferronickel. That market is robust. There are very few new ferronickel operations due to come online. Stainless steel is going to be with us for the foreseeable future. So I think when we look at Araguaia, we're very comfortable with what the market profile looks like for the mid to long term. We feel we can be one of the lowest cost producers in that marketplace and can make very good revenue being in that space. Looking at the EV battery market, nickel is alongside obviously cobalt, one of the main constituents of the cathode in these batteries. I think for the short to midterm, we will still see nickel play as a significant component in those batteries. Obviously, going out evolution and what the next generation and the next generation of battery after that looks like and the constituents of the cathode. We'll have to see what that looks like. But we can supply the market from Vermelio. And the key thing about Vermelio, it does have the ability to go either way. So if you produce the intermediate product, you can send it to the high purity nickel sulfate route for use in EV batteries, or you can send the intermediate product to the metal side. So I think we're fairly well insulated. If there is suddenly a switch in 10 years time to a different battery technology, we're able to move our product around as the market dictates.
You've answered a lot of the questions about financing, Q3, Q4, lots of questions about equity debt ratios. Jeremy, can you raise the equity portion of the finance package with a market cap of less than £100 million?
I think this is always the challenge, and as a management team, we are focused on ensuring that we minimise dilution of our shareholders. I think where we sit at the moment, we've got very strong interest in the equity component from a number of key groups. And the focus and what we have to work on is what is the price point that equity is raised at. Obviously, the challenge we've just come through 3 months of fairly turbulent market conditions on the back of COVID. We've seen some recovery, but we're still not back at levels that we were pre-COVID. So I think that's going to be one of the areas that we're focused on. What is the price point that the equity is raised at? And at the end of the day, it will come down to what the market conditions are at as we move into that process. But I want all shareholders to be aware we are fully conscious that minimizing dilution is one of our key aims.
You're talking about we. Well, Utpal asks, can you clarify what our new director from tech is going to be doing in the next few months?
Yeah, so as you've seen, Alex Christopher, who served on the board for 8 years, has transitioned off. Alex is now running two of tech's major development projects. We're very pleased to welcome Sapanta on the board, who I first met her when she was working with Xstrata Nickel, so she's got a very strong nickel background. And obviously now is VP of business development at tech. So we will be working closely with her and welcome her experience and input as part of the project financing. And also as we look at strategic angles for the business, and that way it may well link into Vermelio and how we advance Vermelio and what we look at in terms of the development profile for that. So she's going to be a very useful addition with her skill base, and we're looking forward to working with her on both of those areas as we advance the assets.
Now, there seems to be a bit of confusion in terms of initials, confusion between JM, Jeremy Martin, and JP Morgan. People are asking, who did they sell to and why, and was it to fund a trip to Barnard Castle?
it's always a difficult point to answer when you have a fund that sells out of a stock. I think in the case of JP Morgan, it's a very simple story. There was a change of fund manager in the early part of this year, and the simple remit is JP Morgan is moving out of the smaller market cap end of the market, and the previous fund manager, who had managed part of his resource portfolio in this smaller junior space, and obviously with the change of fund manager there's been, and you'll see that JP Morgan actually over the last 6 months has sold out of a number of smaller market cap companies, and their hurdle rate in terms of market cap has raised significantly. So we obviously announced they dropped down to a 3% holding 2 weeks ago. It wasn't due to a lack of interest in the stock and the story. It was purely a mandate on the fund. That went to we know one of our other shareholders who was able to participate in part of that sale, and the balance went generally into the market and went to a number of smaller groups and into the marketplace rather than being a direct cross to another fund.
Okay, so that's their loss. How has Horizonte been able to add assets so cheaply? Do the vendors have a completely different view of the market outlook, or is it just down to your amazing negotiation skills?
I wish I could say it was the latter, but no, we've obviously been, I mean, the nickel market's been a very challenging marketplace for the last sort of 7 or 8 years, and we've had a view that quality assets will always have a place in the market. In the case of Valley, I don't think you wouldn't be able to do that Vermelho transaction again today. There was a series of events that evolved, some pressure from different sources, and that was really a pretty unique opportunity to be able to acquire that asset for the price that we did. In the case of Glencore, that was a very simple rationale. It was obviously that asset was developed by Xstrata. Glencore very publicly has said we're not a developer of grassroots assets. However, we're now seeing Glencore at a 6% shareholding in the company. They're very interested in the development of Araguaia, and you may well see them take a more active role, whatever that may be, equity, management, et cetera. We'll see as that goes forwards, but absolutely not. It was not a situation where the vendor said these assets have no value. It's simply a function of where the market cycle was at the point in time. And I think if you look forwards, we're going to see a very tight market in terms of the supply side with a very limited pool of tier one nickel assets. And I think in terms of the interest that we're getting inbound on Vermelho, and if we look back at historic nickel transactions and multiples that they were developed at, we have a phenomenal portfolio today.
Mention that word interest. I'm going to focus on that because many of the people in the room with us are certainly concentrating on it. A great question. It's the last question from us. Given Araguaia and Vermelho are only 150 kilometers apart, surely this could be a single development that a major may be interested in. Are you worried about a takeover, and how can you defend against it? And would you want to defend against it?
I think that's a good question. This is a district scale play. And as we opened up with between the two assets, you've got the ability to build 50, 60, 70,000 tons a year of annual nickel output. And that would be a very significant nickel business. And that would put you on the radar of a number of the major nickel producers. So I think in time, we could and we may well see interest from a number of the major producers. Vermelho in particular, we're getting some very strong inbound interest in Vermelho because obviously it plays into the EV suite of metals, and there's a lot of interest in that space. So I think it is something that as we move forwards and we see nickel price increasing, I think that could become one of the areas that we look at and we see as a real scenario going forwards, and we're seeing already interest today. How do we protect against an unwanted, let's say, or unfair value takeover? We obviously have a number of major shareholders that can effectively work with us to ensure we get the right value for shareholders if that is the position that materializes. So I think, look, our job as a team is to build value for shareholders. Our focus is to build Araguaia, start producing, and let's see how we take the story forwards with Vermelho and what that looks like in terms of value creation.
Thank you very much. Really positive way to end. And we've just had a comment through which says, thank you for the executive briefings. My shareholding will probably increase and diversify as a consequence. Good news indeed. Jeremy, if you wouldn't mind switching your microphone off, because it's a bit rubbish. Thank you very much. Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you, Cahill. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Nigel. Thank you to my glamorous assistants, Ruth and Tom and Craig. And when you find out that your boss has become a backroom boy, you know that these forums are doing very well indeed. We had 700 participants this evening. And just to let you know that presentations and a replay of tonight's event will be emailed to you. All your questions that were asked and weren't asked will be passed on to each of the evening's presenters. next Thursday. I'll be back. Hopefully you'll be able to hear me right from the get-go. Next Thursday is going to be just as revealing when we host Avation, Quadrise Fuels International, OPG Power Ventures, and Shield Therapeutics. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. And I understand that some of our regulars have been affected by the COVID 19 pandemic. Just to let you know that from all of us at Proactive, we are thinking about you and your families. Cheerio, good night, stay safe, stay well. See you again next Thursday.